that and other matters with our political panel now. And joining us, Labor MP for Canberra, Alicia Payne's here. Welcome, Alicia. And Liberal MP for Sturt, James Stevens, is back too. Alicia, foreign aid, why don't we start there since we're discussing it most recently. I think in the early days of government and in opposition, Penny Wong had spoken in the Pacific about Australian aid having no strings attached. And yet, clearly embedded in this policy today are gender equality conditions and climate objectives. They are strings attached, aren't they, to our money?
This is a really important announcement today in showing that we're going to approach foreign aid in a strategic and thoughtful manner and with a, you know, a long-term plan for how we want to do that. And it's also about responding to the priorities of the region, of which climate change and gender equality, as you've mentioned. And something, you know, over the almost a decade of coalition government, they've essentially vacated that space. And this is about making us, again, a partner of choice and working with those partners, particularly in using local workforces and working there rather than enabling, you know, being a fly-in, fly-out partner.
Is it clear to you, though, when we talk about gender equality objectives, how an Australian view of that might align with, say, a remote Christian island community in Tonga, where traditional gender roles, I guess, are culturally different to Australia, or at least historically they have been? How do you reconcile those when you're doling out money?
Yeah, well, as I said, this is about working with our partners and rebuilding those relationships after almost a decade of neglect. So it's very much about listening to our partners and having good relationships in the Pacific and reflecting, you know, their priorities as well as those principles.
All right. James Stevens, does this cause you any concern? It's not a radical change in direction, really, is it? But it is applying some conditions to Australian spending.
Look, on the face of it, no. I mean, I certainly hope, Alicia's mentioned, this is about listening to Pacific Island partners. So I assume they asked for these types of conditions to be put in place on their aid, but we'll hear that from them, whether that's the case or not. I mean, instinctively, we want to be bipartisan in our efforts to continue to develop and deepen the relationship we've got with our Pacific partners. I mean, I actually reject that we didn't do that over the last 10 years. I think that there's been a good history of all governments doing that for a long, long time, including going back to the service of Australians in the Second World War to ensure that our region was free and peaceful, and we want to make sure that continues into the future.
Right, but would you acknowledge a more active step up in at least diplomacy since the change of government?
No, not at
all.
Certainly
the government prides itself on that, it asserts that.
Look, I think there are lots of press releases on their websites claiming that, but I don't think, I mean, let's not forget that for the last few years we had a closed international border.
Sure.
And so obviously the ability of Australian leaders to physically travel throughout the region was different to what it is right now. But today's announcement doesn't include any new money. So I'm sure that our partners would welcome an increase in the aid budget rather than merely a change to the rules. But we're open-minded to working with the government to make sure that we're on a unity ticket when it comes to, as I say, deepening the relationship we've got with our partners in the region.
All right. Now, I understand both of you have been able to update yourselves on some news that sort of developed after question time today. And as MPs would have received letters from constituents, we're talking, Alicia Payne, about war powers and the many requests that have been made to accommodate the parliament more than the government when troops are deployed overseas. The government has settled its position here. There'll effectively be no change. Why?
Well, I think it's really important that we're having this discussion in a time of peace and that we have approached this in a thoughtful manner with the committee inquiry. And as you mentioned, it is something that my constituents raised with me and something that's a lot of concern to people about how the decision to send troops to war is made. And obviously, that is never a decision that any government would take lightly. And, you know, in recognising the role of the parliament in representing our communities, we have accepted the key recommendations of the committee's report to make it continue it being essentially a decision of executive government. And of course, that is also about balancing the timeliness that's required in those situations.
And there are a couple of additional measures that I think are being thrown in, the creation of a committee, but also seeking to codify these protocols. Is that right?
Yeah, so we have accepted the recommendation to establish the committee as well, and that's something that we're looking into the details of exactly how that will operate.
And where do you sit with this, James? I imagine as parties of government, Liberal in your case, Labor in Alicia's, do you think it is exclusively and should remain exclusively the right of executive government to make these decisions?
Yes, look, I certainly do. I mean, I think we've got a robust democracy. Obviously, the executive of our government comes from our legislature. But we all know and respect the fact that there's information that feeds into these decisions that obviously can't always be shared publicly. We receive intelligence from partner governments. Certainly our own national security agencies provide information that ultimately the cabinet, led by a prime minister, acts upon. And look, I think that the history of decisions around this has been appropriate in our country. There's no evidence or justification to change that. Ultimately, someone's in charge and has to make that very difficult and challenging decision. And I think it's appropriate that that is the Prime Minister and the Cabinet.
And it's not that parliamentarians are excluded from having their say on this, Alicia, subsequent to the decision having been made. I think, is that preserved to the best of your understanding under these arrangements?
Yeah, to the best of my understanding, it's just that it doesn't require a decision of Parliament. It is essentially still a decision of executive government.
All right. Now, as a Canberra MP, the seat of Canberra, no less, you may have caught up with Four Corners last night and the ongoing discussion about the use or overuse of consultancies. What do you think this means for the regrowth of the public service? Do you have a clear fix in your own mind on the numbers that might be required to make good on Labor's talk about rebalancing this relationship?
So, as you mentioned, I am the member for Canberra and I'm really proud to represent so many employees of our Australian public service, and having worked in the public service myself, I know what dedicated, hardworking people they are. And I'm really so pleased to see the work that our government is doing under the leadership of Katie Gallagher to rebuild the capability of the public service, because we did see under the previous government a shift too far to using consultants. So there'll always be a role for consultants and independent research or analysis, but this is about rebuilding that capability back into that permanent workforce as a resource for government and a really important part of our democracy.
Are we talking about hundreds of public servants here or thousands extra who might be required to pick up these capabilities?
Well, I couldn't comment on exact numbers, but it is about, you know, bringing that, it's saving money at the same time as building the permanent capability of that workforce. So rather than spending money on work that could be done in-house, it's about bringing that back in.
James, inevitable, do you think, from all that flowed after the PwC scandal and all the other attention that has been focused on the Big Four since there, inevitable that governments almost of any stripe would want to revisit this imbalance, as many people see it, between consultants and public service?
Well, I think it's really a case of watch this space, because it's a lot easier to talk the talk than walk the walk on this, and I am very much an advocate for a fierce and impartial public service providing advice to government, and I would like to see a dramatic reduction in the reliance on external consultants. Governments always like to say they've brought in some company and produce a report with their logo on the front to justify making decisions, but I just don't see any evidence that the government, apart from rhetoric, have got a plan to actually achieve any meaningful change.
Right, but meaningful change, what do you think that might entail as far as the public service is concerned?
Well, that's where my hesitancy and confusion comes from. I mean, I really think ultimately they're saying that a capability they currently rely on from external consultants, I assume, will be replaced by public servants. That must mean recruiting a spectacular... There are thousands of people in consultancy firms in Canberra alone, and the work that they're doing, if it's going to shift into the public service, I suppose, means commensurately, dramatically in increasing the size of the public service in Canberra and that capability. It might be the same people moving from these companies into the public service, and if that's necessarily going to achieve meaningful change, well, like I say, I'll be interested to watch this space in the months and years ahead.
And Alicia, do you think we can expect those details, that form to take shape during this current term of government? How long is it going to take?
Yeah, so the previous government outsourced public service work to the tune of $21 billion. So we are not talking about expanding money here. We're talking about bringing back work that the public service used to do and does, you know, have the capability to do very well back in-house. And also about people within the public service having, you know, job security and permanent roles, and attracting the best and brightest into the public service. Because, and I certainly hear anecdotally as a member for Canberra about people's frustration under the previous government, and this is about rebuilding our public service.
All right. James, I'm going to put this one to you first of all, because it relates to Scott Morrison. You've sat through many questions, Dorothy Dix's, that the government's asked, but two other developments on Scott Morrison and robo-debt today. One is the Greens seeking to have a privileges committee examination into a possible mislead of the parliament. And the other is a motion coming forward from the government itself under Bill Shorten's name that seeks to apologise to victims and I think to hold former ministers to account in some way. Surely all of this becomes a problem for the Coalition or the Liberal Party, having this, what I assume is unwarranted, unwanted attention being paid on the former Prime Minister day in, day out.
Well, look, I'm not as concerned about the politics as I am about the important findings of the Royal Commission, and I completely accept what the Royal Commission found, and there are very important lessons to be learnt from that, and there was immense human tragedy linked to that scheme. So I'll let others make the political points, because I think the people that truly suffered through that scheme are the most important in this, and to the extent that you know, we can learn lessons from it, that's important. If some are playing politics in the parliament with it, that's up to them to explain. But I want to be about constructively learning from this and making sure it doesn't happen again.
And why do we need this motion, the Bill Shorten one, Alicia, which has embedded in it some form of apology as well as holding to account?
Yeah, because I agree with James. This is not about politics. This is about a shameful and dark chapter of Australian government, and many people were hurt, and we've all heard those stories, and in particular some cases linked to suicides. And to see the former Prime Minister come in and, you know, as another example of him failing to take responsibility, him seeing himself as the victim in Parliament, speaking about this, it is just... I cannot understand how someone would do that, knowing what people have gone through as a result of this scheme and seeing the findings of that Royal Commission. And they deserve an apology. They absolutely do. So yeah, that's why...
I think we'll be paying attention to that tomorrow. It may be up for discussion in the House, as I understand it. And finally, we can't let either of you go with the Prime Minister, at least in a preparatory sense, starting to look at the possibility of a public holiday. He wants to discuss this with the states in the event that the Matildas win the World Cup. At least we think that's the scenario that he wants to discuss with premiers and chief ministers. Who'd stand in the way of that, Alicia Payne?
Well, I might say anyone that opposes this would be a bum. I think, like, it's been such a great thing for Australia, for sport, for women's sport. We're all so excited. We had the Parliament lit up in green and gold last night. And I know that here in Canberra, Garema Place was packed with people watching on the big screen. And, you know, we have to win first. But if we do, I think it'll be great to have that public holiday.
There is that. And, a cold Canberra night last night. James Stevens, you may or may not have been aware, but there was a very large gathering downtown to watch the Matildas. Productivity seems very important to a lot of people these days, but would you willingly grant a public holiday if you had the say?
No, I'm a bum. apologies. But, look, love the Matildas and absolutely hope we all get to celebrate their success. But the impact of a public holiday, without being a Grinch, is obviously really significant, particularly on small businesses, and it triggers a whole range of things, which I just don't think it's fair to put that burden on a particular cohort of people that have had a pretty tough few years through COVID, etc., as it is. So I think we can very easily celebrate what we hope will be a famous victory without needing to have a public holiday a week or two later, which I think just has a lot of consequences that are unfair, particularly on, you know, struggling small businesses who have got enough challenges as it is right now.
Well, fair enough. That's a considered position. Does it make him a bum, though, Alicia? I'm not sure.
He couldn't possibly
comment. That would be unparliamentary, to say the least. James Stevens, Alicia Payne, thanks both for joining us.
Thanks, Greg.
Thanks very much.